Elvis would look to his twin for signs of guidance, for signs of strength. Elvis also felt that Jesse was his compass, was a sign of direction, that Elvis should in fact do great things, that had the two of them been united, they would have been able to do great things, that they were separated, Elvis alone had to be the creator, the perfectionist.
Come on, they say when one twin dies, well, then the other one grows up with all the strength and good sense for both.
There's no way anyone would go through there and go, well, that this is not someone who wasn't looking, you know, for who and what he was.
And Bel Air, the sprinklers were going, it was those kind of sprinklers that would move back and forth. And the way that they were positioned, it looked like angels. And Elvis thought he was seeing angels, and he thought that they were calling him.
Lead me, guide me.
So he would go out, and he wanted people to come and see, you know, what he was experiencing. He would see these things, and we would try so hard to see the same things that he was seeing or pointing out to us. It goes to show you his search for answers of some meaning to something. I don't feel he had or felt he had the support or backing or the understanding of who he was.
Music was Elvis's way of communicating with Jesse. The two had been bonded before they were born, intrauterinely, with the rhythm and the voice of the Fundamentalist Assembly of God Church, a very important cornerstone for understanding Elvis.
But I look at myself strictly as a human being, who's, like I said, been very lucky, but whose life has blood running through my veins and can be snuffed out in just a matter of seconds, you know, and not as anything supernatural or better than any other human being.
I'd like to ask J.D. Summer to stay up to sing one of my favorite songs, Why Me, Lord?
He always had questions about why him? Why me? Why have I been given this talent? He never really understood why all the adulation.
I mean, even if you're perfect, I mean, I'm not saying, you know, that I'm perfect because no man is perfect. But there was only one perfect man, and that was Jesus Christ, and people didn't like him. You know, they killed him, and he couldn't understand why.
Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
It's lonely at the top, you hear that, it's a cliche. But for him, it was very true, because I think he was one of the first people to actually get to a place like that that was so, he was in such an ivory tower and so untouchable and so alienated after a while.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to be better far than you are, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. Oh, lift in my quest to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'd only be true to this glorious quest, and my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest, and the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. For this, for another man,
Thank you very much.
Elvis lost sight of his purpose in life, believe it or not. He honestly couldn't understand where it was all going.
I'm not real sure if he knew exactly what his purpose in life was. I don't know if any of us think we know our purpose in life. I still don't know. Let me
see. I don't think he ever understood what his special mission was. Just where I fit
into your master plan. So that put him on this quest, which was his own. You know, it was probably incredibly lonely to be put in a situation where he's on his own trying to find his own.
I was about 14 years old, and he sat down with me and he said, David, Jesus Christ, I know who he is, but who am I?
There was a Greyhound bus next to us with a load of people, and the Greyhound driver with the cap. We both came to a red light. We're at the red light, waiting for the light to turn green. And what do we see? We see the driver get out of the bus, go to the curb, clutch his chest, and fell limp into the street. Elvis said to the driver, open the door! He opens the door. We run out. Elvis runs to the driver, gets down on his knees, and picks the man up, cradles him in his arms, and the man opens his eyes and sees it's Elvis Presley. Elvis says, don't worry, sir, don't worry, you're going to be all right. You're going to be healed. Elvis put his hand on the man's chest and starts to say a prayer, and the guy goes, it's you! It's you, it's Elvis, Elvis! And the guy starts to get up, and Elvis says, no, sir, just relax, just stay where you are. He says, no, it's Elvis, it's you. And the guy starts to stand up. He did get up, and whatever it was, he seemed to be okay. We got him back in the Greyhound. We made sure he sat down, and all the people on the bus looked at Elvis. It was quite a strange moment. To this day, if any of those people are still around, they're telling their grandchildren.
When you're weary, feeling small.
Elvis never was able to resolve his psychological angst over the death of Jesse. It was something that was at the core of all of his behavior. His working himself to death was the desire to reunite with Jesse.
So hush, little baby, don't you cry. You know your daddy bound to die. But all trials won't soon be over.
When I was a child, ladies and gentlemen, I was a dreamer. I read comic books and I was the hero of the comic book. I saw movies and I was the hero in the movie. So every dream that I ever dreamed has come true.